from the sewers, this is the Turtle Power Podcast.
This is your audio source for all the news, reviews, and insight into the world of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Now join your hosts, Brian, Alex, and Darby.
Bossa Nova!
What? Yeah? Bossa Nova?
Chevy Nova? Oh. Excellent!
Now it's time for the Turtle Power Podcast.
Welcome again, ladies and gentlemen, to a brand new episode of the Turtle Power Podcast. I am your mutton-chopped host, Darby, here with my pedo-stashed fearless leader, Ryan. How you doing today, Ryan?
That's terrible.
Why, hey, I've seen you try to grow out mustaches. You're not, you know what, your stash and my chops, it's like we can't top our fathers when it comes to the facial hair features, but we're damn well going to try anyway.
We try and fail.
We try. And you know what, it makes me feel better about my patchiness when I see you try to grow yours. It's great. But we got a lot to get into today. We have so much to get into, so much exciting news. We have Ninja Turtles in museums. We have new additions. We have a Usagi Yojimbo sighting. We also have Lucha Libre wrestlers. There was a lot of them. We also are starting a campaign today. Our loyal fans, we need your help because we are, after 3 years, we're fed up with this. We want Kevin Eastman on our podcast. We want to get Kevin Eastman on our podcast. Our loyal fans, our subjects, our cowabunga dudes, we need your help. We'll get into that. We have video game news. We have comic book news. We have toy news. And we have the mutated messages and a return of a classic. A classic, ladies and gentlemen. Character spotlights are back. We'll get into that. Megan Fox, Ninja Turtle movie, is winning awards left and right. We're going to get into that. Nominations awards left and right. Can't wait to get into that news.
Yeah.
Ryan, are you there? Is your pedo stash still here? Good. Alex will jump on when he can.
Hopefully.
He'll get on when he can. So we're just going to jump right into it with the news?
Let's jump right into it with you know what, before we get into the news, you mentioned something, and this is something that Alex and I actually talked about, and we thought it was time. There's a lot of turtle podcasts out there, you know, and I think
we were the second
and we are actually now officially the longest running. Because the first has stopped publishing. So we are officially the longest running Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles podcast.
All the more reason to get Kevin Eastman on this show.
In existence. Yes, absolutely. So, a lot of the podcasts out there have actually started with a Kevin Eastman interview. I'm pretty sure this is how it went down.
Getting the crap end of the stick on that one then.
This is how I'm pretty sure it goes for a lot of them. Hey, there's Kevin Eastman. Let's do an interview with him. Okay, now that we have an interview, what are we gonna do with it? Hey, let's start a Ninja Turtles podcast, and the first interview or the first episode will be in the interview with Kevin Eastman.
You know, we're the only ones left that were actually around before the Nicktoons or the Nick series even started up.
Absolutely.
Remember when it was like all we had to talk about was the hype for the brand new show, and then a 30-second clip came out. We talked about that for about 2 hours because that's all we had to go by. The IDW.
It's been a while.
And I'm ashamed to admit, we'll get more into that, but I am not kept up as good as I used to back in the day. I've been absurdly busy, but we'll get more into that. But the IDW, we were pre-Nickelodeon. We were back when all we had to talk about was the 87 series, the movies when they were good, and the 4Kids show.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's what we and Mirage
and I think just initial discussions about a movie. I think they're just initially starting to talk about a movie. That was it.
Yep. I still remember when you said you walked out of church one day, looked down at your phone, and you had about 500 notifications on your phone that Megan Fox had been casted as April O'Neil. That's how long we've been around.
Oh, that was a day when Michael Bay said that they were aliens.
Joke's on us, I guess, because Megan Fox is winning awards, and we're going to get into that later on in the episode. The movie's gaining so much attention. I almost said acclaim. So much attention recently, where now, and we'll get into this later. But I'm just hyping it up because we got a lot to get into today. But the movie,
award winner, the actor, Megan Fox.
We're getting there.
Yeah,
they're getting nominated, and it's brilliant. And I never thought I'd be so happy for Kirk Cameron's existence, but we'll get into that as well.
Saved the franchise.
Saved it.
No,
I would say saved it more than Michael Bay ever could.
Saved the movie, definitely.
Saved it more than Michael Bay ever could.
So essentially, what we want to do is we want to put it out there to our listeners, which we know that there's tens of you out there.
Dozens.
At least dozens. There's actually quite a few. We have, I don't want to say more than I'd ever thought that we would have, but we have a lot of listeners out there. So we're putting it to you. This is what we want you to do. We're going to do it each as well. We're going to tweet to Kevin Eastman. His handle is @KevinEastman86. And say something along the lines of, "We want to hear you on the @TMNT podcast."
You know what? I almost want to add, we want to hear you on the longest running @TMNT podcast.
That would help.
We are the longest running.
Yeah.
We are grown men with no lives whatsoever. We are the longest running
@TMNT podcast. Yeah. No, I think it's time. I think that we've earned our stripes. You know, we've put in our time. I've been hearing him do some interviews lately on different shows. I think we've earned it.
He went on Kevin Smith's show. You went on Kevin Smith's show. There's some things there.
We have things connections. To talk about.
Kevin Smith asked him the question that you asked Kevin Smith.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and this is something else that Alex and I were talking about. He came up here, him and his wife came up, down here to Orlando, and we were at Epcot, and as things usually go, the discussion is either probably 40% Star Wars, 40% Turtles, and 20% whatever else. So
Disney.
Yeah. we got talking about this and we just have so many, like, what we want to do is we notice that when he's interviewed, he usually ends up getting asked the same questions. Okay. So what we want to do is we want to ask him the things that are different. We want him to give our listeners a insight into the Turtles that has never been heard of before. So,
heck, I'd be happy to just sit down and just have a conversation with the guy.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
doesn't even have to be Turtles related. We get it. Yeah. He drew the first turtle. Peter Laird drew the second one. Then they drew four. Yeah. We know the origin story by heart. Yeah. We know it.
Yeah. It's,
you know, rags to riches, American dream come true. We get it. I kind of just want to sit down and talk to the guy. Ask him who dresses him in the morning, you know?
Well, and that's going to be part of it too for our listeners. You know, we want – here's something that I have not heard of that any other show has done. We want to take your questions and we want to incorporate them into this interview. So, please.
The weirder, the better.
Yeah.
we're going nuts. We want different questions.
We want specific too. We want
exactly
super specific. So, So tweet @KevinEastman86. Tell him you want to hear him on the longest running Turtles podcast. @TMNT podcast, and we want to make this happen before, you know, the end of 2015 for sure. So let's get on it, and then please feel free to send in your questions as well, and you can send them in now, you can send them in when we announce it hopefully, and we'll stockpile them for that time. So We want to make this happen. Damn it.
I almost, Ryan, we didn't talk about this. How about we give away a prize for the best question, too?
Ooh. We still have a few items left in the, oh gosh.
No, but we would have to go all out. This would have to be the greatest prize we will ever give anybody.
Do you work in the radio industry?
What's up?
Do you work in the radio broadcasting industry?
I do, but I don't get paid for it.
You don't get paid for this either. So, yes, that's a great point. We still have a few items left in the bin here that I got from Nickelodeon, a couple of figures that they were kind enough to send me. So, carded figures. And old figures. So
this
we got some new ones. We got some old ones.
The end all of prize that we give.
So that's a great idea. So to the best question we get for at Kevin Eastman 86, we will definitely send you a.
Because I mean, if the fans get Kevin Smith on our podcast, we have to give back to the fans.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
Exactly. Needs to be done.
So let's you know what? I think that's good for that. Let's go
jump
ahead
into the news.
Let's get into some news.
April O'Neil, Channel 3 Eyewitness News.
Wake up news, yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Thank you. Thank you for doing that.
It's hard to live up to Alex's, but I had to try.
That's pretty good. It's pretty good. I think he would be proud of what you did with it.
Or he would call me a sack of crap for even trying to replace him. Anyway.
True.
First story we have up for news items today. Toonzeum in Pittsburgh, ladies and gentlemen, presents TMNT 30 Years of Turtle Power exhibit. This story comes from ninjapizza.net that from February 7th, so, you know, at the beginning of this month or last month, depending on what day this episode comes out, to April 26th. Toonzeum in Pittsburgh is presenting Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 30 Years of Turtle Power. Ryan, what can you tell me about this one?
I mean, you pretty much covered it all. I do not live in the greater Pittsburgh area.
I know one person who does.
I mean, I know a couple people that live in Pennsylvania, but they're more, I think they're closer to Philly than Pittsburgh, but
what I understand, the Northeast is very tiny. You can get to like any state in about 30 minutes.
That's true. That was really random for me living up there when I was up in Maryland, and you know, you drive for 15 minutes, you've gone through 3 states. So weird.
Which is so weird for us Floridians.
Yeah, for Floridians.
Or this Coloradoan now.
Key West to Panama City, you drive for like an entire 24 hours straight, and you're still in Florida. So
yep. Yep.
So this is going on out in Pittsburgh at the Toonzeum. That's awesome, by the way, a museum of cartoons. It's fantastic. This is actually being curated by a friend of the show, former guest Andrew Farrago.
Nice.
Of the Ultimate Visual History. That's kind of his second job out in, I believe, San Francisco. He is the curator of the museum out there. So, he helped with this museum piece, and it's going on until April 26th. So,
and just for point of reference, you can get from New York City to Pittsburgh in less than 6 hours, according to Google Maps.
There you go.
So you know what? If I could get there in 6 hours and stay at a friend's place, I would be so free to do so.
Yep.
I would be all about it.
Should mention hours are Thursday through Sunday, 11 to 5. And it's $8 for adults and children 13 and over. So you can get all the details. You can check out the link in the show notes over at ninjapizza.net.
So for less than the price of a craft beer out here in Colorado, you could actually go see the Toonzeum and check out the Ninja Turtles exhibit.
Yes. Craft beer, that's the big thing there, huh?
Some microbrews left and right. Not all of them are over $8, but some of them can be.
Well, you know, one place you won't be able to find a lot of beer is at the Nickelodeon's Kids Choice Awards.
Unless you want to get arrested.
It's true. Well, this year TMNT is represented in 4 categories. The Nickelodeon,
which proves that, I'm sorry, kids' opinions on movies compared to adults. Anyway, just don't even matter, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah. Good point. Well, the Nickelodeon cartoon series is nominated for favorite cartoon. So they got that one right.
They did. They did.
But that's kind of a Homer choice, right? Because it's on Nickelodeon. Do they have an unfair advantage there?
Isn't it voting? Oh, they could just rig the voting.
Exactly.
You know what? Congratulations to the Ninja Turtles, Nick Turtles, for winning Best Cartoon at the Nickelodeon Kids' Choice Awards. I'm sure they'll be staying at the Nickelodeon Hotel in Orlando as well.
Oh man, that would be so awesome if they held that.
Preemptive strike. Congratulations to the Nick Turtles for winning the Nick Choice Awards.
Come on, Nickelodeon, sweets. Get on it. We got to bring this here to sunny Orlando, Florida. Bring the Nickelodeon Kids' Choice Awards here.
That is funny.
Well, as you mentioned, though, the blockbuster movie. Blockbuster movie. It is a blockbuster.
It is a blockbuster.
Is nominated for favorite movie. It is nominated for favorite actor in Will Arnett and favorite actress in the one and only Megan Fox.
In Megan Fox's butt. What? Well, the kids don't care about that, I guess, as much as the adults who pay for the movie tickets do.
The dads do. You might have some dads going, hey, little Jimmy, did you vote on the Ninja Turtles?
Did you vote for Megan Fox?
Yeah, make sure you vote to get today. Did you vote today? Okay. No, you didn't vote today. You voted yesterday. Make sure you vote today, too.
You have your parents' permission to vote for Megan Fox.
Absolutely.
Just saying. Megan Fox already won an award. We'll get into that later.
Yes. Yes. She did win one award already.
Yes. But that's movie news. That's further on down the road.
Yes. So this was pretty cool. I have Google alerts on for Ninja Turtles, right? And so I get some random stuff sometimes, and this is one of them.
Which explains our show notes that you sent us out.
Exactly. So this is a Lucha. This is the title. Lucha Libre may have too many Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles stables.
Yes, yes. This article coming from UpRocks with two X's.com. From the glorious world of Lucha Libre comes perhaps the greatest thing that the writer has ever seen. Alianza Universal de Lucha Libre, or AULL, may be getting a cease and desist order here pretty soon. They have a website fresh out of 2001. They have a squad of Ninja Turtle wrestlers. This was great. This has to be like the front page story of our show notes. Because they have a squad of Ninja Turtle wrestlers. In wrestling, Ryan, we know they have stables.
Yes.
Wrestlers pair together, team up, form teams called stables, take out their enemies. So one squad has created, with their wrestlers Leonardo, Donatello, Raphael, and Miguel Angel, collectively known as what? Tortuguillos Caretacas. Yeah, you like that?
Karate Baby Turtles.
You like that Spanish? The Karate Baby Turtles or Hatchlings.
Yes.
They took on International Wrestling Revolution, their own Tortugas Ninja. Leo, Mike, Raffy, and Tilo.
Tilo?
Tilo! So basically four Ninja Turtles from one Lucha Libre organization took on four Ninja Turtles from another Lucha Libre organization. And Ryan, what happened in this fight?
Well, I can't tell which group is which.
One has stripes. The other ones don't. I've noticed that.
Yes. I don't know if the stripy ones are the karate ones or if the stripy ones are the ninja ones, but I mean, I'd say that the stripy ones have better costumes. The unstripy, they look more like they're wearing like catcher's mitt, like, or not catcher's mitts, but like catcher chest protectors.
You ready for me to throw an old school WWE reference at you?
Yeah.
They look like they're wearing the chest protectors that D'Lo Brown used to wear.
Oh, very nice. WWE. Yeah, there you go.
Except they're the color of Ninja Turtle shells, so they're yellow chest protectors.
Yeah.
Except for one of them has a blue one.
Yeah.
Tilo has a blue one.
Again, this is one. Now we say check the show notes for stuff. This is one you have to check out.
Like this has to be the front page news.
I think this is going to be the album artwork actually.
Right.
This is going to have to be the artwork. Yeah.
So, but anyway, during there's a this video. Fight between these eight Ninja Turtles, Ryan, what yeah. happened?
Well, let's see. It's not the best wrestling. Let's just start there.
It's Lucha Libre, so it's actually entertaining.
It is entertaining. There's not a whole lot of people in the audience.
About six.
There's yeah.
I'm not exaggerating. I'm counting like six people in this GIF right now.
Yeah. Let's see. There's a quadruple. There's a quadruple. A lot of things.
Yes.
There's a quadruple
suplexes. Quadruple dive through the ropes yes. onto the quadruple people on the floor. But then another group of turtles ran in.
Yeah. Well,
Las Tortugas Mutantes.
Oh, is that what it was?
Also known as the Mutant Turtles, who apparently are just dudes in black shirts and toothy masks, decided yeah. to interject.
Yeah. See, now, I thought they were like foot soldiers.
It just says black shirts and toothy masks. They call themselves the Mutant Turtles.
Yeah. I think there's something lost in translation there.
Quite possibly. But you know what? They attacked with another group called Los Bastardos, who could be the foot.
There you go.
But they're not turtle themed, so apparently nobody cares. But due to this run-in, it was announced that the four groups will meet at a later date.
Oh, this is fantastic.
These costumes are great. It's ridiculous. I love it. But I also love the picture where they apparently pull a tiny kid Splinter.
Yeah.
Wearing what looks like a werewolf mask.
Yeah, it's definitely a werewolf mask.
Yeah. Totally. With werewolf mittens. And yet the kid still looks like a better Splinter than the Michael Bay Splinter does.
Oh, man.
Apparently Lost Tortugas is the only one that has their own minty Splinter. So look for Lost Tortugas to win that the rematch.
Well, the line right at the bottom gives me an idea, though, that there definitely needs to be a match of whether it's, you know, one of these four groups, whichever one, but they need to take on Kevin Nash in a
Super
Turtles
Shredder
versus Super Shredder match. Absolutely.
I think Kevin Nash Super Shredder could take all 16 of these guys.
Probably. Yeah.
Yes. Easily. And, oh God. I'm trying to figure out if these outfits are worse than the next mutation costumes, because they're pretty bad.
Yeah, these are pretty bad. These are pretty bad. I
believe Leonardo has a star on his mask. Michelangelo seems to have polka dots on his mask.
Artistic renditions.
This is great. We'll have to ask Kevin Eastman who he thinks is going to win this fight, and he'll say, whoever's the last to file my cease and desist order.
There you go. So out of one fighting style and into another, this is pretty cool. We all know Usagi Yojimbo, right? We all know the character and his connection with the Turtles. Well, it looks like there is going to be an upcoming Usagi Yojimbo. Is it Usagi or Usagi?
I'm gonna go with Usagi. I think he says Usagi in the movie or in this little clip that we have.
Yeah, and there is going to be an Usagi Yojimbo. Stop motion animation film?
It's a short film and a direct DVD feature.
Yes.
I don't know if it's going to be stop motion, but the clip we have is stop motion because they wanted to give Stan Sakai an idea of what they had for his movie in order to get the movie rights from Stan Sakai, which they succeeded in doing. So props yes. to these guys for that.
Yeah, they talk about that this was a proof of concept. You know, they're saying that the real exactly. film is going to look 100 times better.
Yeah, the budget's more than $10, so yeah. that helps.
But it's pretty cool. You know, I'm looking forward to seeing this. It is, yeah, like you said, it is going to be directed DVD, no release date yet. But, you know, we'll try to keep an eye on this and keep you guys updated for when this movie is released.
It's pretty interesting. I mean, watch it and just realize that, like you said, it's a proof of concept. Like, yeah. this is what we have in mind, because they do it on a shoestring budget. They said it in the interview, like, Man, just imagine what we can do if we actually have a budget. So go to our show notes and watch this, because it's, you know what? It's 7.5 minutes long, and as a proof of concept, it's pretty legit, and it actually makes me look really forward to this direct-to-DVD feature.
Yeah. Speaking of other shorts, just quick aside, did you see the Power Rangers short yet?
You taking a crack at my height there, Ryan?
No, no.
Sorry, we can't all be behemoths like you.
No, the one with James Vanderbeek.
I did see the Power Rangers short, but what I think is funny is, I mean, it's a dark one, and that's kind of the edge they're going for. I just think it's kind of funny when these fan-made films come across better than and the 10-minute fan-made films come across better than the 90-minute to 2-hour long blockbuster movies.
Oh, dude, we've seen Turtle shorts that are better than than the Michael Bay film.
Exactly. And it's like, what are movie come on, it's the internet nowadays. There are pop icons that have started out on YouTube.
Absolutely.
You know? Yep. Why can't movie executives look at these brilliant 10-minute long fan-made films and go, you know what? These guys are legit. These guys have done stuff with a tiny budget that have gotten better reviews than our blockbusters.
Yep. It's true.
Here's hoping. Here's hoping. I'd be down for a Power Rangers remake, only if Jason David Frank is in it.
Well, they are making a new Power Ranger movie, but no details about, you know, the scope of it.
If Jason David Frank's not in it, I'm not going to watch it.
I don't know, man. I don't know if he's going to be in it or not. I know.
I want Jason David Frank more than James Vanderbeek. Okay.
Yeah, I know this dude. I know that he can. Green Ranger can still kick some ass. I know that.
Green, red, white. God, he's been almost all of them, hasn't he?
It's true.
How great was that episode when every Red Ranger showed up? I'm sure you love that, since the Red Ranger was your favorite.
Red Ranger was my favorite, yes. I'm not sure if that had to do with the fact of, you know, who he was, or if it was because of Raphael. It was Raph.
It was Raph all the way, dude. You always went red.
Yeah, I did.
And then I liked the Green Ranger, and now the Green Ranger went red and showed up when... Did you see that episode, by the way, when all the Red Rangers showed up?
I don't think so.
You need to go back and watch it, dude. It's literally, I forget what the episode's called, but literally every Red Ranger, like from the past shows, come back.
I've heard about it, but I don't think I've seen it.
Yeah, you need to check it out.
All right.
Going on tangents here. See, Ryan, it's great when we talk about, you know, some other things besides the Turtles sometimes.
It is.
Fans are into it. We're going to get into that in the mutated messages too later on. I have to laugh at you for something.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah. You're getting a nice I told you so later on today in the episode.
I know what it is anyway. Damn, so,
right,
hey, did you get any new additions?
I have one coming.
Ooh.
I have one coming. I'm going to get into that with the mutated messages.
Oh.
But Ryan, I understand that you did as well.
Yeah.
You have new additions.
I got, do you remember the Diamond Select Toys mini bus banks?
The little piggy banks?
Yeah, these were the ones that were created using the actual 3D models of the Turtles from Nickelodeon. You know, from the animation studio at Nickelodeon. They actually gave Diamond Select Toys the 3D models so that they could create these banks. So a former guest on the show, Dakota, who lives here in the Orlando area as well.
Nice.
He let me know that he grabbed one at his local Toys R Us because they were on clearance. And so definitely want to appreciate or send out some appreciation to him for giving me the heads up. So I ran over to my local Toys R Us, because if you don't know out there, Orlando's gigantic. So,
it's enormous.
Yeah. So between where he lives and where I live, there's probably 10 different Toys R Us's. So
it's more than just Disney World.
It is. It is absolutely more than just Disney. So so luckily, though, I went over to my local Toys R Us, and they did have some left. And it was interesting, though. I think I know why they went on clearance.
Why is that?
They were beaten up pretty good.
So you like picked it up and slammed it on the ground like in Big Daddy, and you're like, hey, 20% off.
If I'm pretty sure somebody went and did that to every single one, because there was like scratches, a lot of haters out there. Markings. Well, I think it was the packaging. I think what Diamond, I don't know if it was Diamond Select or if it was their packager or whatever, but they, I think what they did was they took them all and they just threw them in a box. And so, and then, you know, the box gets transported and shaken and everything. And so, like, I'm pretty sure that the paint from different turtles was getting, like, making little marks on all the other turtles. So Raphael's chest would have, like, a blue streak from one of the Leonardo's headbands. But Leonardo's got some
sounds
orange.
Like Leonardo and Raph are getting pretty freaky.
Yes,
in the box.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Definitely in the box. So
it's in a box.
I was able to find a Raph that was pretty much unscathed, and it looks fantastic. It looks really good. So I've got it up on the shelf now, and yeah, it's solid looking, man. I'll tell you.
Ryan, would you say that little crack on Raph's chest plate is the chip on his shoulder that we all know he has?
Oh, wow.
Have you never put two and two together and realized that?
No, that's fantastic. I like that.
Oh, yeah. It's got a little chip on his shoulder. You never noticed that.
Never noticed that. No.
Yeah. Drop some knowledge on you. Yeah.
You definitely
see what happens when I move to Colorado? My mind expands. Like, Raph has a chip on his shoulder.
Well, speaking of expanding, let's expand into video game news.
I always have to duck and cover when that song comes on. I get the worst flashbacks, man.
Yeah.
I get the worst PTSD flashbacks with that theme.
So speaking of PTSD flashbacks, I wanted to talk a little bit more about Danger the Ooze. You might be saying...
More?
Or?
There's more to say?
There is more to say. You might be saying to yourself, there's no video game news. Ryan, what are you talking about? Well, yes, it's true. It's not really news. But I just... So I've been playing Danger the Ooze more.
Why?
And I think I'm done.
I think I'm just done.
Yeah.
I think I'm just over it.
It is quite possibly one of the most aggravating games I've ever played.
Okay.
It's incredibly repetitive, and I was trying to get the platinum trophy on it, right?
And you think it's not worth it anymore.
No. Even with the fact that you can beat the whole game in an hour, because one of the trophies is beat the game in an hour. Trying to do all the other stuff is you have to kind of... this. Remember, as I said before, this is a game where you go through a door, you go into a new area. You go back through that door, back into the area that you just were, and all the guys that you just killed are all back.
Right. Sounds like the first Ninja Turtle game.
Yeah.
They did it all the time.
That first Ninja Turtle game is, you know, pending being
man.
So incredibly difficult.
It took me
difficult.
30 minutes to kill all 40 guys in this room. Oh, I got to go back and get that pizza. What the?
Yep.
No!
Yep. So maybe that's what they were going for. I don't know, but I'm done with it. I'm gonna let Alex borrow it. He can try.
He can keep it.
Yeah. I've got a lot of other video games to play, and I put in a solid half a day on this one.
You poor man.
I was just completely I'm done. I don't need to do this anymore.
Here's my take on these games. Okay, I was thinking about this a couple days ago. At my house. I have been playing two games at my house. I have been playing The Last of Us, and I have been playing Dragon Age. Okay? I have been playing those games.
Yeah.
I have been also playing at a friend of mine's house. I have been playing Infamous Second Son, and I have been playing this game that came out fairly recently called Dying Light. Have you heard of this game, Ryan?
Yep.
These games... are brilliant games. I'd probably take Second Son out because out of those four, I feel like that one doesn't belong, but it's still a great game.
Yeah.
There are these companies out there that make brilliant games. And Dying Light is amazing. It is fun. It is, you know, the storyline's whatever, but it's not even the storyline. The gameplay is so much fun. I enjoy going over to my friend's house and playing this game. And I have not had that sort of feeling with a Ninja Turtle game since you and I were growing up on Fort Myers Beach and we would play Turtles in Time on the Super Nintendo.
Sad, isn't it?
And, yeah. It's out there. There are studios. You know what? I said it earlier with the fan-made movies.
Yeah.
These fans come up with 10-minute movies on a crap budget that are better than actual blockbusters of the same property rights that they're portraying.
Yep.
And I know there are independent game makers out there that could just make a brilliant Ninja Turtle movie.
They could.
Maybe that's something I need to ask Kevin Eastman. Like, well, hey, Kevin, like, why don't you look into some independent video game makers and see which one can make a Ninja Turtle game that would gladly give me this feeling again?
Now, I think that's great, but here's the problem. Is that
he doesn't own the video game rights.
He doesn't own it. It's Viacom, Nickelodeon, and they've given the rights.
But doesn't
to...
he know anybody that he can talk to, or sure, at least just bring it up? Sure.
You could. We could talk to him about that. But
who do you think?
It's Activision has it right now, and Activision farms it out to whoever the hell they want to.
Now, here's the thing, though, Ryan. Who do you think could make a better Ninja Turtle game for less money? Anybody Activision hands that contract out to? Or an independent gamer that's really just trying to make a brilliant game so he can get his name out there and make whatever it is he wants to make.
Well, we kind of saw that with Out of the Shadows, right? I mean, that was something they were really trying to do. And I don't know if it's a situation where... I mean,
Out of the Shadows had so much potential, it was ridiculous.
It did. And that was definitely a small indie studio. And they definitely had issues, you know, technical issues. I mean, the launch of that game on the Sony platform was delayed how long? I mean, it was months.
Months.
So I don't know. I mean, you look at a situation like that and a company is going to get scared. They're going to say, well, we don't want to do that again because the same thing's going to happen.
But the constant 4/3 out of 10 ratings they get on IGN and other websites are going to keep them selling it out to the better, quote unquote, better companies.
I think it all comes down to the bottom line with them. As long as they're making money, you know, if they can make a really crappy movie, well, if they can make a really crappy game for $100,000 and sell $200,000 worth, then they've made $100,000. You know, it's just nothing for them. So they don't care. As long as they're making money. Now, but here's the thing. We know that this can be done right. All you got to do is look at Batman Arkham, the Arkham series.
Such a great series.
So good. And there's so much hype for this next iteration. And I mean, everybody's talking about it's rated M for mature.
Yep.
Batman.
Yep. Hey, have you seen the DC animated movies? They're not for kids.
Yeah. But there's a lot of kids that go see them. There's a lot of toys that get sold.
Yep.
You know? So that is actually one of the questions that I'd like to talk to him about, like to talk to Kevin about is, you know, the options of a mature Turtles.
Yeah.
You know? Can we see this?
Oh my god, the original. I mean, if you read the IDW series, or if you read the original run
on
Mirage.
Oh, Mirage was real dark.
You could make a brilliant, mature-rated game for the Ninja Turtles.
Totally.
Easy.
Totally.
So easy. And yet, it's so frustrating when, like you said, you're like, I played Danger of the Ooze, and I think I'm done with it.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to loan it to Alex, and you know you're going to be like, I don't care if I ever get that game back.
Yeah, that's correct. That is correct.
But if you mailed me Turtles in Time to play on the Super Nintendo, even though you probably haven't played it in like 20 years, you'd be like, Darby, I kind of want that game back now.
Oh, absolutely.
Are you done?
Bro, you gotta get that back to me.
Yeah, Darby, I haven't played it in like 15 years, but I kind of need it back.
Totally, absolutely.
Oh,
well, that's all I want to say about this game. It's just
and that pretty much ends my rant too. And it's just I've been playing so many brilliant games lately, and the fact that the Turtles just keep coming out with crap after crap after crap is
I've gone back to the old Uncharted. I'm on 2 right now. Going back.
What did Naughty Dog do before the Uncharted series?
Oh, they've done a bunch of stuff, but I mean that they hit new levels with Uncharted though.
They hit new levels with Uncharted, and they did Last of Us.
Yeah. Yeah. Last of Us, an amazing, amazing game.
Oh, there's a reason why it won all those awards and why it's the game of the year and why it constantly was rated as high as it was.
Yep.
And you mean to tell me? And here's the thing. Have you heard of Shovel Knight?
Yeah.
Shovel Knight was created by an independent gamer.
Yep.
Who literally just put – I think he put it on Steam or something like that. I saw it on Steam Train. I saw it on Game Grumps. And it's like that game, even though the graphics are like Nintendo graphics, maybe Super Nintendo graphics, it's fun to play.
Yep.
Gameplay. Just give me a turtle game that's fun to play.
Yep.
Please. Ugh. All right.
Well, speaking of characters, or speaking of toys, I should say.
Or something that's fun to play with, that would have been the better segue.
There you go.
Ryan.
There you go.
There's a reason why I drive the show now.
That's right. Let's get into
collecting news.
From Playmates!
Well, one thing the Turtles seem to do well, at least according to the top-selling toy list, North American toy fairs, and so on and so forth, is they make pretty good toys. The TMNT are actually the top-selling traditional toy item of 2014, beating out such big names as anything that had the name Frozen on it, Barbie, Disney, Hot Wheels, yeah, all taking back seats. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, number one from Playmates of 2014. According to MarketWatch.com, they have the story. And I love that the actual story, Frozen's Elsa doll is not the top-selling toy. That's actually what it says.
Yep, yep. I think maybe it's just surprising, I guess. This is the NPD group. I mean, they're kind of the ones in charge of keeping track of all this data. And, sure enough, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles figures assortment, number one. I mean, it's fantastic for the Turtles. This is news that has not really been out there.
Nope.
Which boggles my mind that people aren't talking about this. Turtles beat out Frozen.
Maybe Disney paid a lot of money to keep that on the DL.
Maybe. It
makes sense in a way if you think about it, because all the little girls, all they want is an Elsa doll. They get that one Elsa doll. One little boy wants at least 4 Ninja Turtle figures.
Mm.
If you think about it.
That's a good point.
One Elsa doll, 4 Ninja Turtles.
Well, you got to have them fight against
somebody. Sister in there. That's 2. Throw the snowman in there. That's 3. That's about it. Do you really want a Sven doll for your little girl? Does a little girl really want a Sven doll? No, she wants the snowman whose name is escaping my head right now. What's the snowman's name, Ryan?
Olaf, thank you.
They want Olaf and Elsa. That's it. Maybe the sister. Isn't it sad that I don't remember the sister's name and she's kind of the main character
Anna.
Of Frozen?
Anna.
Huh?
Anna.
Anna. Okay, see, you have a wife who's also
no,
Disney,
I live at Disney, so
yeah,
I see this every day. This is why it blows my mind, because I see Frozen everything everywhere.
You should wear your Ninja Turtle shirt next time and be like, go up to get your picture taken with Elsa and be like, yeah, you lost out to these guys. Just going to point that out.
I will definitely sit in line for 5 hours and go up and see Anna and Elsa and say, we're number one. No, that's not going to happen.
You know what? If you recorded like the 10-second reaction, that'd be worth posting on our website.
Well,
or tweeting out.
Here's the thing, though, is that there are not kids lining up for 5 hours to go see Ninja Turtles.
There were when we were young, Ryan. Were when we were young.
Yeah, at studios. Yep. At the time, Disney MGM Studios.
Yes.
Now Disney Hollywood Studios.
And my parents constantly remind me about how long they waited in line in the scorching heat so I could get Donatello's signature.
Yeah.
It's there. They constantly remind me. But congratulations to the Turtles for beating out Frozen, Hot Wheels, Barbie. What bothers me, though, is number 5 on this list is a Galaxy Tab for kids.
Yeah.
Kids with their toys today. They get tablets.
It is top-selling traditional toy items. That's how this is labeled. And a Galaxy Tab 3 is on this list.
On number 5.
What is a traditional toy item to these people?
Kids with their tablets, man.
There's number 9 is a tablet. Number 5 is a tablet. Number 4 is essentially a tablet. It's Leapfrog. None of this stuff was around when we were kids.
I know, man. I remember when my parents were like, hey, we're going to Disney World. It's going to take us 3.5 hours to drive there. I'm like, cool. Let me put my tape deck and my Sony Walkman and my headphones on and listen to this while I lay down in the car for 3.5 hours.
You had Teddy Ruxpin. I remember that.
I had Teddy Ruxpin and Grubby. Don't forget I had Grubby.
Oh, that's right. That was a little worm, right?
Yeah, Caterpillar. Caterpillar.
Yeah, whatever.
Or Grub. His name is Grubby.
Yeah, good point.
It's Caterpillar. Don't be hating on my Teddy Ruxpin.
No, I'm not hating.
You ever put a death metal cassette tape in a Teddy Ruxpin?
I think I've seen that on YouTube before.
It is my sister. I remember she had a Nirvana cassette tape and a Nine Inch Nails cassette tape. Yeah, she did that. You talk about wanting to put my Teddy Ruxpin away and never see him again. Holy crap, does that scare the bejesus out of a 6-year-old child? Yes. Yes, it does.
That's fantastic. Well, in other toy news, because they've been selling so well, the North American Toy Fair recently just took place in New York. Some people call it New York Toy Fair, which I think is probably more accurate in the fact that it is in New York. But anyway.
It's kind of like how the World Series is only played in America.
That's right.
Unless the Blue Jays make it. But that's rare.
That is very rare. So there's been a lot of stuff, you know, that was released, a lot of little things. We're not going to get into everything that was announced there. We're just going to touch on a couple of the big things. The Good Smile Turtles line that was based on those James Jean statues. We talked about this in the past.
Which I would be so okay with if this is what they looked like in the actual TMNT movie.
Sure. Yeah. Unfortunately, they don't.
Nope. Michael Bay was like, what is the worst possible concept? Are we? There it is. Okay, yeah, that's what they look like.
Well, we'll have links in the show notes, as always, for all of this stuff. But those are those statues that we've talked about in the past. We talked about the Leo. I think that was the first one, and then the Raph. They've announced the Mikey and Don are going to be coming as well. And,
clearly, Donatello's the last one that's going to be released, because if you look at the concept art picture that we'll have in the show notes, Donatello's at the top and he looks like a boss.
He does look cool. The way he's holding the bow, just holding it like he's like a bat.
Yep. He looks like a boss.
Pretty solid.
He's literally standing up there above the other three turtles and he's like, this is how it should be. I'm at the top.
This is how it should be.
I'm at the top. Guess what? None of the turtles are still alive today if it weren't for me. It's true. If you watch the Nick series, how many times were they all mutated and Donnie's like, oh, I reverse engineered you in a barn.
In a barn.
I didn't even go to like a hospital and use scientific equipment. I used an IV drip in a barn in upstate New York in the middle of nowhere and reverse engineered you back to normal.
Well, that explains his full name, Donatello MacGyver. Yoshi, right? Or no, Hamato. Because the last name's first, right? Yeah.
I believe so, yeah.
Yes, yes. That's what it is. So,
think about it. They all have the last name Hamato.
Yeah.
I never realized that before.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Good job, Ryan. Blew my mind. It's not the Raph with the chip on his shoulder that I threw at you, but it's a good one.
Okay. Well, I'll take that. I'll take what I can get.
Yeah. You might do it again later on in the show. We'll see.
Yeah. Hey, you, did you ever get any of those Turtle Legos? Turtle Lego sets?
No, I did not.
Yeah, well, if you want any, you better try to look for them now because the license with Lego is done, kaput.
I might have to make a run to Target here pretty soon.
See if they have any left. But this is interesting because the link is no longer active. But the Turtles are now going to be teaming with Mattel and their Mega Bloks line.
I don't want Mega Bloks. I want Legos. These are Mega Bloks.
Yeah. And this is really strange because Michelangelo was just in the Lego movie.
He was.
And played a...
I believe he sat next to Michelangelo in the Lego movie. Michelangelo. Dumbledore. Brilliant movie.
You know, it's just kind of a peculiar move. There's some... Obviously, something happened there with Nickelodeon and Lego. Perhaps somebody wanted too much money, perhaps.
Reality, Superman would have just destroyed everybody in the Lego movie, but they depowered him so Batman would look cool.
There you go.
So Will Arnett could voice him, which is fine.
Yeah.
It's fine. In reality, Superman would just go OP on every single one of them, but whatevs.
Whatevs.
By the way, going back to that statue, that Michelangelo statue, according to the website, it's currently available for pre-order with free shipping, and it's scheduled to arrive in April.
Yeah. What is it going for? It's not cheap.
No, it is not. But it's not the $700 one.
No. This is like $200 or something, isn't it?
You know what? If I had the money, I'd rather shell out. Like, this is a legit statue.
Shell out. I see what you did there. $129.29 U.S. dollars.
$130 each times 4 is what, Ryan?
That'd be what, 520?
It'd be 52. Good job, Ryan. But it's true, it is 52. So $520 for the set.
Yep.
Plus tax.
Which is cheaper than one of the other ones.
Of the Michael Bay statuettes.
The Michael Bay statuettes. Yeah, so you can head over to Entertainment Earth, and they've got it up for pre-order.
Exactly.
All right. Next, we'll talk about Playmates because they're the big winners. They're the big dogs in the Turtles universe.
And there's, I want to get into this, Leonardo, and I'm sad that Alex is not here to talk about this. But apparently there's a 24-inch Leonardo Ninja Turtle, which transforms into a complete sewer lair playset.
That's right.
That's crazy.
Yeah, we've never seen anything like this, have we?
Not with
a full turtle, I don't think.
I don't think so. Not a 24-incher. But apparently, yeah, this is ridiculous. It provides, 9 different rooms and has 30 features, including spring-activated surprises, false floors, and so much more, according to the press release. I wish Alex was here to talk about his favorite guy getting a 24-inch playset where you can, just play inside him all you want.
So,
that was dirty.
you're terrible. So there's some interesting things that came out of this though. I've seen interviews with Ciro talking about how, characters get leaked, a lot of times through the toys. And, this has happened with all the big lines, Star Wars has had this happen. This has happened to Turtles plenty of times in the past. This has happened last year.
Bebop and Rocksteady, anybody?
Yeah, Bebop and Rocksteady. The LARPing ones, the LARPing turtles.
Yep.
We first saw the LARPing turtles from last year's Toy Fair.
And we thought they were just like another money grab, which they kind of are. But it's like, hey, it's like, like Space Raff or Detective Dawn. Like, hey, they never do this in the show, but if we dress them up, people will buy them.
Well, that's true. Well, here's the thing. So I guess we should say a spoiler alert for this, but if you check out this is out there, so
it's out there. Too late. It's out there.
It's out there. If you go to check out these photos, there is a Dimension X line with a character that sure as hell looks like the Fugitoid.
I'm so glad he's making a comeback.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. I mean, he's a huge part of the Nick Turtles.
Oh, he's a huge part of the Four IDW Kids series. Turtles and the Mirage.
Yeah. And let's see, we've got the mutated versions of Shredder, which is an old Mirage. That's an old Mirage line from the old comics. We've got Muckman.
Oh, Muckman.
I mean, he's just right out there. There he is.
There's Muckman.
Yep. I mean, so this is big news. I mean, we're getting some characters that we did not know that were coming to the Turtles line. So
God, if I could just get the picture that Good Smile is using as their concept art for their toys, I'd be all about just having that picture. Donnie looks like such a boss. I'm sorry, he does. It's awesome.
It does not, though. I guess we'll just get this out of the way now. I do not see a normal Cry figure at all.
It bothers me so much that they release toys for figures that haven't even been on the show yet.
Yeah.
And then they just, normal Cry? Nah, screw you. Screw you, Darby. That's something I need to ask Kevin Eastman. Can I just get my Karai figure now, please? Can Alex get his Karai figure so Leo will have someone to do besides Raph? You know?
Yeah. Well,
Just saying. God. The boggles. It's like, Ryan, I just feel like that's the most basic idea. Like, well, we've done toys on all these other characters. We need to come out with more toys. I feel like she would be like the first one you'd think of. She's from season one. She's from the beginning, and like whatever.
Well, I
kind of a big deal.
And this is something that's going on with Star Wars too, with the with Rebels, is that the female figures were delayed for months behind the male toys, the male figures, the male characters.
Right.
And there's a lot of internet hubbub about it. And I think it's a thing where the companies assume that that sure the majority of the people that are going to be buying these toys are male children, right?
Right.
But what they're assuming, I think incorrectly, is the fact that they assume that male children will not purchase female characters.
Really? Because that April O'Neil toy came out pretty freaking quickly.
Yep. And I had multiple Aprils. That is definitely, and I probably would have had more if there were more offered. There was not a lot of female characters in, the old series. It was pretty much just April and Irma. And there was an Irma
eventually. Mona Lisa was a one-off.
Mm-hmm. Just the fact that we have a Karai in the show is great. It's another female character. But the fact that she doesn't get a normal figure is just mind-boggling. So
also too, like I know a few girls, my cousin's daughters come to mind. They love like comic books and superhero stuff. One of them doesn't even wear like little girls. She wears Superman underwear and Spider-Man. Like that's what she wears.
True.
And it's like, there's that market. I mean, there's that market of girls that like comic books and Superman and Spider-Man. And it's like, you guys are winning the toy war against Disney and Elsa. So like, why not?
Yeah, I think they can.
That's like a whole other market that they could be going for, but
yeah, I think they have room to take a couple of what maybe quote unquote risks, what they might consider risks. So.
Oh, if you're number one, yeah, you can take risks. What, you're gonna fall to number three and suddenly your year's a failure? No, you still sold millions and millions and millions of dollars worth of toys.
That's assuming it doesn't sell.
Yeah. Yeah. What's the worst that can happen? You still make millions of dollars. Oh, life is hard.
Well, beyond that, beyond the fact that we've got some new characters coming, we do have the Party Wagon, which we've seen concept art, or I shouldn't say concept art. We've seen studio photos of. Well, it was there. It was there at Toy Fair, so hopefully we see that coming to stores here real soon. Fantastic looking. You know, recently made its way onto the show, so we should be seeing it come to stores real soon here. There's a, you know, there's a lot of little cars that they're working on, kind of like Hot Wheel type things. You know, your standard, you know, RC stuff. We're getting a toy of Ice Cream Kitty, so that's fantastic.
You know why they got that? Because Kevin Eastman voices it.
Oh, of course.
Or did. I don't know if he does anymore. Does he still show up randomly
Jessica,
and just go,
there's an Ice Cream Kitty toy? You just hear my wife out in the background saying that. We're getting a, here's another spoiler, a Mondo Gecko. Mondo
yes.
Gecko's coming. There's a toy of Mondo Gecko. We've got a toy of Napoleon Bonafrog.
the most unoriginal character
version
that they've come up with. Yes.
Yes. It looks pretty solid, though. It looks a lot like the character in the show. Dream Beavers.
All these one-off guys getting action figures before Karai.
Yeah. Yeah. There is a character here who I do not know who it is. And
which one?
I'm very confused as to who it might be. If you go to the first link in the show notes.
First link, okay.
And then go to view all the thumbnails.
No, that's the oh, you mean in the collecting news section?
Yes.
Okay, let's see.
So there's this character. It is Orange, Toy News Eye. We're getting all our information. We should give them a shout out to toynewseye.com.
Toy News Eye. Okay, the Playmates Toys, TMNT Showroom product images.
Yep.
Okay.
And then go to view all images.
Hey, look at that. Okay.
And then go, or view all thumbs, and then go to the very last page.
Just view all 117 images.
Yep.
This may take a while. I love these scuba suits that they seem to be in. The Dimension X ones.
That's the Dimension X ones, yeah.
Yeah, it's just funny that they wear scuba suits.
So there's this orange guy. He has horns.
He has horns, okay.
And he has, like, what appear to be, like, cow feet.
Oh, I can already hear some fan being like, you idiot, this is clearly the name of this guy.
Right, so then we're going to need one of our listeners to write in, tell us who this character is.
I would almost bet he's got hooves.
Yeah.
Okay. He looks jacked as hell.
Yep.
Looks like okay. Never mind. He's not the cow.
He's got like ram horns.
He's no wolf. Idea. No idea.
So oh everybody, my God. Go to the show notes. Be? Check it. Go to the. What is it entitled? Toy Fair 2015 Playmates Toys TMNT Showroom Product Images. Go to the very last photo.
And if somebody could tell us who that is, that would be fan-freaking-tastic.
And yes, tell us who this is. Because we don't know.
It must be a Mirage character that they're bringing back or something.
Maybe.
I could see it. All right, let's move on.
All right, let's move on.
Get on with it! I can already All hear right. the Monty Python guy screaming that.
So, out of collecting news and into
TV news, yo.
Nice. I was mentioning some Ciro interviews. Well, we've got a link to one of them in the show notes. It's pretty interesting. You know, he talks about kind of the leaks and stuff like that that we mentioned. But
he likes Muckman too.
It's actually it's an older interview, but they just posted it now over at denofgeek.us. So yeah, we got a link to this interview in the show notes. You know, check it out. It's interesting.
Yeah, he actually mentions a lot of characters in this. I kind of like this interview because they straight up just say, like, are we going to get this guy? And he's like, no. Are we going to get this guy? No. Are we going to get this guy? Maybe.
Yeah.
You know, they mentioned Half Court, the basketball playing giraffe, when they were like, are we going to get Ray Filet? And he's like, well, we have a basketball playing giraffe. Apparently, we're not going to get Ace Duck.
Yeah, he said, I'm devastated.
He said, I don't know if we'll ever do a show about Ace Duck, but we had to serve them a little bit here and there. They've got some really good stuff coming up in season 3. It gets crazy. That's what he said.
Yeah.
So still waiting on Ace Duck, Ray Filet. We did get Pizza Face. I'll take Pizza Face over Ray Filet. I still want Mondo Gecko, though.
He had a good look.
What?
He had a good look.
Who? Ray Filet? Yeah. He was blue. He was my favorite color. Yeah. Even though Donatello's my favorite. Shut up. Don't judge me.
I ain't gonna say none.
Yeah. I already hear Alex giving me shit. It's,
you know,
fine.
the Nick Turtle series was back for a little while, and it's been gone again for a little while, but it is coming back March 8th. So, you know, set your DVRs, watch live, whatever.
You know what I'm curious about, though, Ryan?
Watch online.
What I'm curious about? So we've got Terfleidel, Michelangelo, Terfleidel.
Yep.
Superhero alter ego, Terfleidel, where he's a giant butterfly. Who was Michelangelo's hero in the 87 series? Who did he read the comic books about? Who did he finally get to meet as, like, his all-time favorite hero?
In the 87 series?
In the 87 series. Come on, Ryan.
I can't remember.
There was an episode about it. I believe it was even one of the when Pizza Hut gave out, like, VHSs of each turtle with their one episode, it was the one they gave out for Michelangelo. Michelangelo meets who?
I don't know. You're going to have to save me.
Bugman. When are we going to get Bugman? He was a good character. He showed up for, I think, just one episode. But he could turn into a bug when he got really pissed off. And April fell for him because she's a slut like that. And she's like, wow, a guy who's not trying to kill me that also isn't a turtle. That's rare in New York City. So,
yeah.
I'm just saying, Mikey's got the Terfleidel. Why not bring Bugman in?
Sure. Why not?
Why not? They didn't ask about him in this Ciro interview. It's actually a pretty good interview, though. I'm not going to delve too much into it because I'd rather just leave it up to the fans to read, because there's a lot of questions. There's a lot of, like, you know, three-word answers.
Yeah.
He does mention the leak, though, like the Bebop and Rocksteady leak.
Yeah.
I guess he wasn't too happy about that.
No, I can't imagine he was.
Yeah. He always says, too, I like it. They were like, the toys leaked it, wasn't it? And he says, yeah, and if someone doesn't leak it by accident, it's always the fans somehow figure out a way. They'll find Toys R Us. What's it? They'll find Toys R Us SKU numbers. Like, yeah, it's crazy that they go to, like, such lengths to get these leaks if it's not accidental. Whatevs.
Yeah.
So, for show notes, I mean, for the, not show notes, for the TV news, no Ray Filet yet, no Ace Duck yet. He loves Muckman. All right, Ciro, good job. We're still waiting on Mondo Gecko.
This is another guy I'd like to have on the show.
Ciro?
Yeah.
He seems like a pretty cool guy. He knows his, he clearly knows his stuff, obviously.
Oh, yeah.
With all the, you know, we've talked about it before, all those Easter eggs and callbacks they do to the 87 series or even the Mirage comics. It's like, all these kids are like, who the heck is this character? And it's like, oh, that was an issue, you know, 37 of the original Mirage run back in 1984.
You know, I friend requested him a long time ago, and he never accepted.
As the podcast or as you?
As me.
Yeah, try doing it as the podcast. That name carries more clout than our names alone.
Good point.
Yes, it does. You'd be like, oh, friends. This podcast wants to be one of my friends. And then he accepts the request, and then we just hit him every day with, when are you going to come on? When are you going to come on? We're the longest-running TMNT podcast on the air right now.
In the world.
In the world.
Ever.
in the world ever.
Yep. So.
Yeah.
So March 8th, Bebop and Rocksteady are making their, well, I guess not their debut. I guess they debuted in the last episode.
Spoiler alert. Really?
How long do you got to wait? Like it's been out there. They're tweeting all about it. You know, TMNT Master on Twitter is tweeting all about it. Getting the emails if you're in the TMNT fan group online. They just tweet or they just sent an email out to everybody.
You know, Darth Vader was Luke's father.
What?
Spoilers.
But Kaiser Soze? Are you all caught up? Are you all caught up with the Nick Turtles series?
Did you know Darth Vader was Kaiser Soze?
Hey, are you caught? No, seriously, are you all caught up?
I'm not all caught up. No, I apparently lost my Hulu account, so I'm finding other ways to watch the show. I'm not all caught up. I'm working.
You can watch it on Nick.com. They've got all of the season, I believe, right there.
Sweet. Now I know where to go. Learn something new every day.
The last two episodes, in particular, you know, a lot of shows do this. You know, they have a period in the show where they have to kind of, you know, wind up to something. They're building up to something big. And, you know, Northampton, you know, returning to the woods, that's what this season so far has been. It's been rejuvenating the series and building up to this big change, this big event, the return to New York. And the last two episodes specifically have been amazing.
I'm still having trouble with Seth Green as Leo, though.
Just keep watching. You will get used to it. I promise.
Mm-hmm.
You'll get used to it. I'm not saying it's better or worse. It is very Seth Green. And if you heard Seth Green a bunch, then that is going to make it harder to get away from, you know, being like, hey, wait, that's Seth Green. That's not Leonardo. That's Seth Green. That's Seth Green. I've heard it.
With Jason Biggs, like, I've heard Jason Biggs plenty before, but I was never like, hey, that's Jason Biggs. I was like, that's Leo.
Yeah.
And but I know Alex hates Jason Biggs. I know he hated him as Leo, but I just feel like he was a better Leo. Far better Leo.
Well, just keep going with it. By now, I've gotten used to it. I'm not saying it's better or worse. I'm just saying I've gotten used to it.
It's worse.
Oh, man. Well, it's definitely catch up. Specifically, the last two episodes have been absolutely fantastic. That's for everybody out there. Like, Nick.com. You can watch all the episodes from this season, I believe. And the return to New York. What's going on with Splinter? What's going on with Karai? What's going on with the Krang? We got to see a little bit of that. I mean, they've taken over. This interaction with the Krang and Shredder. Well, we just, if you see the, you know, the leaked photos from Toy Fair, that
Shredder's about to go even more
BA. We're going to see some mutated Shredder.
Kevin Nash is about to show up.
A la old school Mirage.
Oh my God, what if they got Kevin Nash to like voice that Shredder?
Oh, that would be cool. That would be cool. It wouldn't be the first wrestler on the show.
It wouldn't, but I gotta tell you.
The Finger. Jesse Ventura.
Oh, the Finger. I gotta tell you though, Kevin Michael Richardson as Shredder is amazing.
Oh yeah.
It's so funny, too, because I honestly feel that's just how Kevin Michael Richardson talks. That's just his speaking voice. I was watching How I Met Your Mother, and he shows up in one scene in How I Met Your Mother, in one just out of nowhere, and it's like, it's Kevin Michael Richardson. He's talking. He sounds like Shredder.
You know, I think I remember this. I think I remember seeing this, but I don't recall the episode.
He writes a love letter for them. He like tells them what to write down or something, and his words are brilliant and his voice is booming, so they instantly just fall in love with him. I think Robin goes on a date with him at the end of the episode. But you know, he's great as Cleveland Jr. Like, it really shows his range, but I honestly feel like Shredder is just his normal talking voice.
He's got a very James Earl Jones thing going.
And if I ever meet him, or if we can ever get him on the show, I really just want to say, please tell me you're an immortal made of stone. To me, that's just the best line in the entire movie. You fools, we are mortals made of immortals made of stone. And I'm just like, fucking duh. I'm pretty sure the 90 minutes leading up to this scene has already pointed out plenty of times that you are immortals made of stone. And yet it doesn't hurt the Ninja Turtles at all to punch and kick them. Go figure.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well,
Kevin Michael Richardson, everybody.
You should try to see if you can get him on. See if you can get him on.
All right, our fans, we need you to tweet Kevin Michael Richardson. He follows us.
He does.
He follows Speed Force Radio, too. I was like, why the hell is Kevin Michael Richardson following Speed Force Radio? We've done two episodes, like, last year.
Well, he listened in. He thought it was good.
Or he has somebody else running his Twitter account for him and doesn't really pay attention to his Twitter account.
Could be.
I'm going to go with that one. Yeah.
Before our voices get any higher, let's go into...
comic
book news.
I strike two on my way down. Donatello takes out a third with his staff. Already the pudgy ones are starting to panic. Raph loves this stuff. He's not alone.
Why is he narrating? Is he crazy?
Hardcore crazy.
I love these guys!
I want to hear Kevin Michael Richardson also do that monologue of Leo.
he would do a really good job with that. Yeah.
That was the best Leo voice.
Really?
I don't know. It's just so... Come on, the Mirage Turtles are so BA.
Yeah.
They literally beat up the other eight Ninja Turtles in like 5 seconds.
Hardcore,
and they give
man.
Them crap for it, too.
Hardcore Love crazy.
Them. Huh?
Hardcore crazy.
Oh, yeah. Like, they're just like, hey, there's eight Ninja Turtles. Let's beat them up. And we're done.
So, how far away are you from California?
I am quite a ways from California. But I do have family that lives in San Diego.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, IDW is going to be moving their offices to a new location, and their new location is going to have a gallery. And guess what?
What's up?
The first exhibit in this gallery will be an extensive showcase of the work of Kevin Eastman.
Well, yeah.
He's a local local San Diego resident. Did you know that?
I did not. San Diego.
So, yeah, they're going to be hosting a big turtles gallery. I'm sure there'll probably be some other stuff in there. Maybe some heavy metal, or maybe some of the other comics that he's worked on, some of the one-offs that he's done. So, so this is pretty cool.
I wonder if we can get our boy Bobby Kernow to give us a tour of the facility if we should ever go there.
You better. Bobby!
Dude, Bobby was so great. I loved when he was like, man, I thought this was going to be like an 8-minute interview. We've been on the phone for an hour and a half. It's like, yeah. That's just kind of what we do.
Yeah. Gosh, that would be awesome. So we'll see. For working for the Navy, you'd think I'd be out to San Diego by now, but it hasn't happened yet. This is going to be in Point Loma, right next to the Navy base, too. So
what's up?
It's going to be in Point Loma, which is right near the Navy base. So you got to get out there.
Yeah. Why don't you just start planning that with your bosses? Like, hey, maybe I need to go out to San Diego.
I need to trade a Australia for a San Diego. That's what.
No, I would take Australia.
Well, I already went to Australia. And I'm going again. Is that too much?
I hate you so much, Ryan. God. According to Google Maps, I am 16 hours away from San Diego.
Oh, bro, you got that.
Yeah, it's a 2-hour flight.
Yeah, you got that.
Yeah, maybe. We'll see. I have no money right now, so funds a little low for me to go to San Diego. I did not mean for that to rhyme. I'm sorry.
See what you did there.
Yeah, I did not mean to do that.
So let's talk about what's out now. IDW series issue 43 was released 3 days ago as we're recording this. It was released on February 25th.
Way to date the show, Ryan.
Yep. Let's see. The TMNT Ghostbusters crossover miniseries is completely out there.
I need to actually get the trade paperback for that.
Yeah, the fourth and final issue came out in January. The trade paperback is coming when?
April 22nd with the director's cut coming out May 20th. Hey, Ryan, that's around my birthday. Yeah. Mm. I feel like by the time you could get that and send it out here, it would be my birthday.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah. This is the part where you go, what did you get me for my birthday?
Well, so the trade paperback is a trade paperback. We know what a trade paperback is. You just collect all the issues, put them in a book. There you go, trade paperback.
That's all you need, man.
What is the director's cut, though?
I have no... It literally just says director's cut, crossover from 2014 returns with the director's cut edition. Ah, Tom Waltz, Eric Burnham, and Dan Schoening all give behind-the-scenes testimonies detailing the creation of the story and reveal all the Easter eggs hidden in each issue. Perfect book for any TMNT fan with a birthday around that time.
Good point.
Yeah.
So that's coming out. And the Mutanimals, issue one, we talked about this in our last
episode.
To
check that out because just released. That looks awesome. There was actually – I was on Reddit today, and if you go to the TMNT subreddit, so if you go to reddit.com/r/TMNT,
yeah,
there's already a review up for the actual – for the first issue.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah, I'll go to it right now and so I can give credit to whoever wrote that.
So
keep going.
Issue number one just came out also on the 25th. And IDW Adventures issue 20 also just released on the 25th. Did you hear about this? There was like a backup of
By the way, the cover looks awesome for it.
Oh, yeah.
Have you seen the cover?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, totally.
The cover with Mondo Gecko / Old Hob, Pigeon Dude, whose name I don't remember. Like, they look, I mean, the Pigeon Dude doesn't look badass, but the other ones do.
Oh, yeah.
Jumping off a building. By the way, tmntentity.blogspot.com is the one that did the review that I just talked about.
Oh, that's a great website. That's the website that I use for my chronology when I'm reading the IDW series.
Yeah.
I use that website because they kind of put the comics in order based on because, you know, you get all these, you know, miniseries, you know, issues, and they kind of they don't all go in order necessarily. You don't read, like, you know, the regular series issues, you know, 4 through 8, and then read the miniseries. No, they're like the miniseries issues fall in between sometimes. So,
right. By the way, also, this series, Mutanimals, I'm just reading a little bit right now of the the plot, the summary, and it's dark. I mean, come on, it's a group of mutants led by Old Hob. You know it's going to be dark.
Oh yeah.
Oh. I need to get that one. I might actually just get into that before I even catch up on the IDW actual series. For some reason, those characters. Not evil, anti-heroes always kind of do it for me, unless it's Superman or the Flash, because those guys are awesome.
There you go.
Or the Blue Lantern Corps. Shout out! We'll get into that later.
Let's see, what else do we got here?
IDW Adventures, Nick Turtle's Adventures number 20, released February 25th as well. Mirage Comics, trade paperback number 9 and trade paperback number 10, which collect TMNT volumes 2, issues 10 through 13, is coming in April 15th.
Yeah, so this was the one, the last episode we had not received word on this issue if it was going to be coming out, because all we had at the time was that number 9, trade paperback number 9, which I do have. Because I'm using this as my way to collect the volume, Mirage Volume 2. And we had no word if it was going to be coming or if it was going to be continuing. So we do have word, though, that trade paperback number 10 will be coming. So that's great.
Also, trade paperback number 6 is out currently.
That's for Tales of the TMNT. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's Mirage Tales of the TMNT Volume 2. And number 6 is, once again, all we've got word on. We do not have any word about if they are going to be continuing this yet.
Got it. Mirage Volume 1, City at War, single issue color classics, releasing over the next few months.
Yeah, they're releasing. Basically, as you just said it, all the issues for the City at War. Obviously, they're back in the Mirage days. They were all black and white, so they're having them colored, and they're releasing them in individual issues over the next few months.
I always picture, like, the Mirage, like the old school Mirage that were black and white. I always picture Shredder's color scheme to be the one from the Tournament Fighters.
Mm.
Sort of like the reddish costume.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, that was different, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, but that's always how I kind of pictured it.
Mm.
And maybe then, that's where they got it off of.
And then
another question to ask Kevin.
Yeah, definitely.
What color was Shredder originally? Like, what color scheme did you have in your head when you were drawing it out?
Well, in IDW, he's got red in him.
He does.
So. And then Archie, no change from our last episode. The original Archie's Adventures trade paperback volume 9 collects Archie's issues 37 through 40, and no further news on the Archie Adventures front. So.
All right. That's going to do it for comic book news. Now, I want to get into all these awards and accolades coming for the movie in movie news. For some reason, I thought we had a different soundbite for that. Anyway, movie news. Guess what, Ryan? We said it earlier in the show. Megan Fox, awards left and right. Nominations left and right for the TMNT movie. Kirk Cameron, not just a savior of millions of Christians, but a savior of the TMNT franchise. Razzie Awards are out, ladies and gentlemen. Ahead of the Oscars that happened, you know, fairly recently, the Razzie Award winners were announced. Congratulations go out to the TMNT movie for getting 5 nominations.
5 nominations.
But only 1 award.
Kirk Cameron could not get Best Supporting Actress.
He could not get Best Supporting Actress, which is why Megan Fox won the Razzie Award for Worst Supporting Actress in a Movie. Congratulations go out to Megan Fox for her recent Razzie Award.
Yeah, it's amazing. She won Worst Supporting Actress, and then she's also up for Best Actress at the Nickelodeon Awards.
Which, hey, Nickelodeon owns the Ninja Turtles. I wonder, you think clean sweep, best picture, best actor, best actress?
Could be.
Like I said, shows the kids' opinions. Yeah.
Well, yeah. What else? What were the other nominations?
Well, let's see. They were nominated for Worst Picture, along Left Behind, The Legend of Hercules, Transformers, another Michael Bay movie. Good job, Michael Bay, for having 2 pictures in the Worst Picture category. Sadly, they could not win the award because Kirk Cameron's Saving Christmas won for Worst Picture. Kirk Cameron also won for Worst Actor when he played himself in Kirk Cameron's Saving Christmas. By the way, Ryan, I'm just going to pull this up right now because I pulled it up earlier. Kirk Cameron's Saving Christmas, the plot, as explained to me on Wikipedia, after explaining why he loves everything about Christmas, Kirk takes his brother-in-law, Christian, on a tour to convince him that various popular elements of Christmas are biblical. No sh**!
Booyakasha!
The two then return home for the remainder of the family Christmas party. Christmas is biblical? What? Like, what?
Yeah.
Oh, God. Anyway, Worst Supporting Actor, sorry goes out to Will Arnett. He was not even nominated. Mel Gibson, Kelsey Grammer, both in The Expendables 3, by the way. I love that you can get nominated for multiple pictures Schwarzenegger was in there too for Expendables 3. Kelsey Grammer won Worst Supporting Actor for Expendables 3, Legends of Oz, Think Like a Man 2, Transformers Age of Extinction. He won for all of those.
Impressive.
I know, right? With that work, with that like resume of work, Kelsey Grammer's a brilliant actor too. The fact that he was nominated for in this many movies is sad. He's a great actor if he's playing Fraser Crane and Sideshow Bob.
Oh, he's great as Sideshow Bob.
He's brilliant as Sideshow Bob. And I love that he shows up as Sideshow Bob. He'll say like two lines and that's it.
Yep.
And I just love that. I love that he's like that dedicated to it.
Oh, yeah.
Kiefer Sutherland was also nominated for Pompeii. Worst Actress, Cameron Diaz won that one for The Other Woman and Sex Tape, beating out such powerhouses as Charlize Theron for A Million Ways to Die in the West. Andrew Barrymore's Blended. I swear to God, Adam Sandler just makes movies so he and his friends can go on vacation. Doesn't even matter if it's good.
Yeah.
Cameron Diaz also, here's the thing, Cameron Diaz lost Worst Supporting Actress for Annie. But here's what I love. The Turtles were nominated for Worst Director, going out to Jonathan Liebsman for the TMNT movie. Who did he lose out to, Ryan?
Kirk Cameron.
No, he lost out to Michael Bay for Transformers Age of Extinction.
Oh. Sad,
Jonathan's like, man, even when I make a
Booyakasha!
Movie, I still can't win an award because I lose out to Michael
Booyakasha!
Bay. It should be Michael Bay's middle name. Michael Bay. That's just what it should be.
Well, let's see. What else? What else?
Oh, Turtles were also nominated for Worst Remake, Ripoff, or Sequel. They lost, however, to Annie. Transformers Age of Extinction also nominated for that award. Kirk Cameron and his ego won the award for Worst Screen Combo, which I think is freaking hilarious. Any Two Robots for Age of Extinction was also nominated. It literally says Any Two Robots. Worst Screenplay. TMNT was nominated for this as well. However, losing out to Kirk Cameron Saving Christmas.
That I will actually give props to the fact that they beat out Worst Screenplay.
The fact that that's like an award you really have to try hard to win.
You do. You have to try really hard to beat out.
I mean, A Million Ways to Die in the West did not win for worst screenplay or worst combo or any of that. So you really have to try hard.
A Million Ways to Die in the West had some pretty funny parts in it. I will say that. And some.
Well, it's like 43. 43 is a horrible movie, but it's hilarious especially if you're high as hell. Oh my God, is that movie funny? Kirk Cameron Saving Christmas. Thank you, Kirk Cameron, for saving the Ninja Turtles franchise. Turtles franchise winning one Razzie out of the five that they were nominated for.
Is this
because Kirk Cameron could not be nominated for Worst Supporting Actress. So I'm not going to hold that against Kirk Cameron.
True.
But congratulations, Kirk Cameron, and congratulations to the TMNT movie on your awards.
Yeah.
I do like how they have a Redeemer Award, though. The Razzies, have you seen this?
Yes.
And Ben Affleck actually won it because he went from Geely to Argo and Gone Girl.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know what?
He turned his career around.
You're legit. And that's what I tell people. When Ben Affleck was announced as the new Batman, everyone keeps saying, oh, he sucks. He's horrible. Look at Daredevil. Yeah, Daredevil was crap. But he's also won how many Oscars since then? Yeah. Exactly. I'm just saying, Ben Affleck's legit. Any haters? Anyone who comes at me with hatred for Ben Affleck, you know, it's like I said earlier with Michael Bay and his scoreboard, like, yeah, I still made $160 million for the Ninja Turtle movie. Ben Affleck just points to his Oscars. Like, look, I've got Oscars now. Yeah, I made crap movies. I made fun of myself in Jay and Silent Bob how many times?
Sure.
He admits it. He made crap movies. But you know what? The dude's legit. And any haters who want to come at me, I'll defend Ben Affleck. I'm gonna say it right now.
Did you see Gone Girl?
What?
Did you see Gone Girl?
I did, and it. You know what? Had that movie come out maybe a little later, it probably would have actually done a lot better with Oscars.
Yeah,
that's the thing. The Oscars came out. The Oscars happened, and then like a week later, Gone Girl was released. You know what I mean? So they're like the first great Oscar-nominated movie of the Oscar season. It's like, yeah, well, he's not gonna be nominated because it's a week after the Oscars happened.
Yeah.
So.
Yep. So let's see, what other movie news do we have here?
Jeremy Howard on Donatello's relationship with April O'Neil, TMNT 2 Expectations.
Yeah. Did you read this at all?
I skimmed it.
You skimmed it? Yeah, I skimmed it too.
Because I really don't expect anything out of TMNT 2 and Donatello and April's relationship. I'm sorry. Did they have one in the first movie?
No.
Exactly. If anything, Raph and April would have had one, right?
I guess more
so than
they
hung out together
others,
for like 2 minutes
time.
On screen.
Just time together, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like the only alone time that April had with any turtle was Raph when they got kidnapped.
Yeah. Well, they oh man.
What?
I can't believe this is happening already. They're shooting this movie like next month.
Yep.
April.
Yep.
Anyway.
People are trying. Do you feel, Ryan, real quick? Mm-hmm. I literally just thought of this. Do you feel, now I'm a Donnie guy.
No.
Booyakasha!
I'm a Donnie guy. Do you feel like a lot of people are pushing for a Donatello April thing? Because we'll all admit it. We're pretty nerdy guys. They want the nerdy turtle to get the girl. Not the hardcore badass bruiser like Raph or the leader of the group, Leo. They want the nerd who saves the day God knows how many times to get the girl.
Well, I wonder if that has anything to do with the relationship that they have in the Nick Turtle series.
I was thinking that too, but I mean,
Mikey was the one that was all over her, though. In the movie?
Yeah. Because he's the youngest, most immature one, so of course he's going to be like, oh my god, a girl, you know?
Yeah.
But
I guess.
Do they want the nerdy, quiet one to get the girl? Possibly.
Yeah. There's also an interview with William Fichtner. This one actually has audio. Again, link in the show notes. You can check it out. He is not a whole lot of big news that's coming out of this. He's talking about Shredder, talking about playing.
I do like though that in the actual URL address it says. It literally says, William Fichtner talks Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, not playing Shredder, returning for the sequels, and whether Michael Bay is a raper of childhoods.
Yeah.
That's in the URL, ladies and gentlemen. In the URL. I am literally right-clicking right now on it, and I hit go to this page, and the URL straight up says that.
The interesting thing that he does talk about is he talks about what we all have known, that they filmed the movie
where he was going to be Shredder.
He was going to be Shredder, and then they changed things
because comic book nerds were like, "What do you mean he's not going to be Japanese?"
Yeah, and then they came in for reshoots, which is when they introduced the Japanese Shredder
guy, guy whose face you never even really see.
Do we even know if his name is Oroku Saki in the movie? I don't even know if it even
I don't think
that.
They even brought it. I'm going to say no, because he was originally it was originally supposed to be this guy who was supposed to be Shredder. So
but yeah, he'll be back for the next one. And that the interviewer talks about what do you think about all this internet stuff about Michael Bay raping everyone's childhoods? And he's like, Armageddon didn't rape anybody's childhoods.
Armageddon wasn't based off of a childhood franchise.
Yeah. He didn't get it. He did not get it at all. And the interviewer was too nervous to.
I forgot he wasn't Armageddon.
Yeah. So, this is a good time to mention the fact that now neither you nor Alex nor I have purchased this movie, correct?
That is 100% correct.
Yeah. So now when I was on my flight to Australia a few weeks ago, it was on the flight and I did watch it again. Second time total.
Okay? Did you just have your face in your palm the entire time?
Well, I was maybe foolishly hoping that the second time around, maybe it would be better.
Nope. It's not, is it?
No, it was no better.
I think it's hilarious too. I could just see a scene. I can already see a scene on a like a Family Guy or something, you know, where it'd be like, "Oh yeah, would you like to watch? We're having the Ninja Turtle movie," and it's like, oh, "Okay, I guess I'll watch that." And it's like, "It's $1 for headphones." No. No, yeah, I don't think I'm going to watch it. I think I'm going to be bored for the next 2.5 hours.
So here you go. That was actually a perfect example, right? So if the flight from Orlando to L.A., it was on the flight, but it cost like $1.99. And I was like, nope. Nope, not watching it. And then the flight from L.A. to Sydney, it was free. So I was like, okay, I'll try again.
I don't think they can legally charge to watch movies on airplanes when you're going from L.A. to Australia. That's just inhuman. I'm sorry. Yeah. What about Wi-Fi? Do they charge you for Wi-Fi?
There is no Wi-Fi when you fly across the Pacific.
Is that what the planes don't have it?
No, not for that type of a flight, because they get the Wi-Fi signal from ground towers.
Ah.
Yeah.
Learn something new every day. That's the second thing I've learned today.
Well, that's the last we're going to talk about the 2014 Turtles movie. But, you know, this is the 25th anniversary of the R Turtles movie, right? The original Turtles
movie. Yes, it is.
And
we're going to get into that with mutated messages, actually.
Yeah, I think I heard Kevin Eastman talking about it in an interview and just mentioning the fact that, you know, we don't have any, like, director's cut of this movie. It's a shame. I mean,
yeah.
Because he was talking about how they shot all these extra scenes for that original movie and they've just never seen the light of day. And I don't know. I'm sure it would be an absolute nightmare to try to get all the parties involved to do this. And it's certainly out of our control. But God, that would be awesome.
Let's ask Kevin if we can get him on.
Yeah, totally. If anybody would have the clout to do it, it would be him. So.
Of course. Or Peter.
Yeah.
All right, well, that's going to do it for the movie, like you just said. So now let's head into my favorite part of the show. We're going to do some mutated messages, Ryan?
Mutated messages.
There's no sound for that, is there?
Sounds weird when he says it.
Sounds weird when you say it.
And once again, I'm just a lying piece of crap. our first mutated messages, and my biggest I told you so to Ryan, comes from Tim Garcia. I hope I'm saying that right. God, I never really it's funny. I'll look at our fans' names on their Twitter account, but I'll never say the name in my head. I'll just say, like, Tim, okay, that's cool. At TimG311, he sent us a picture of his workstation and was apparently very happy to hear that I am a huge fan, because I totally called this out. I was a big fan of his Blue Lantern Corps symbol that he had on his computer. What I didn't go on to tell him was that I'm a big Flash fan, and I actually have a shirt that is a Blue Lantern Flash shirt. So when I know the Blue Lantern Corps, it's pretty legit. I'm a huge DC guy now, and he was really excited to hear that I am a fellow fan of the Blue Lantern Corps. All will be well, Tim. All will be well. And it got me thinking, yeah, I'm a big Blue Lantern guy. Ryan, if you were in the Corps, I'd say you were green. I was jokingly going to make a joke about Alex being Atrocitus in the Red Lantern Corps, but he's not here today.
Oh, yeah, that was a good one. Yeah, you definitely, yeah.
Shut up. You don't even know what I'm talking about.
No clue.
You don't. God, man, get into other comics.
I am reading other comics. I'm reading the new Star Wars comic now.
What? Oh, really, Ryan?
Star Wars
really?
One. Marvel.
Really, really?
Back.
Really, Ryan?
Ow!
Are you really going to try to play your I read comic books game by bringing up Star Wars comics?
Nah, talk about Star Wars.
Really, Ryan? But anyway, Tim, all will be well. Thank you, sir. I'm glad that you were excited to hear that I am a fan of the Blue Lantern Corps. I am. I've got the Flash Blue Lantern shirt to prove it. I am huge into DC and the Lanterns at Blackest Night, Brightest Day. Ryan, seriously, get on some of the Geoff Johns DC comic stuff, because that stuff is freaking epic, all right? Johns, one of the greatest comic book writers all time. He's done stuff you probably didn't even know that he did. He's huge. That's true. Read some Geoff Johns DC comics, okay? He's doing New 52 Flash. He's helping out with the Flash TV show. Come on, dude. Get on it. You know what? I'm going to find, because you got me like the Peter Laird signed TMNT comic, I'm going to find like a good trade paperback, and I'm just going to send it to you, and you better read it. I don't even care. I'm going to make you do a review on what I send you on the TMNT podcast, because believe it or not, we actually have other interests besides Ninja Turtles. And I know our fans do as well. So I know they like to hear about it from time to time, and I'm happy to give it to them. All right. It's going to end that one. So
I ain't going to stop you.
Big I told you so to suck it to Ryan.
Yeah.
Voltron Ranger at Voltron Ranger, ladies and gentlemen. Voltron. He sent us a trivia question.
Voltron.
What'd I say?
Remember Voltron.
Oh, sorry. Voltron Ranger at Voltron Ranger. Sorry. I was too busy telling you to suck it to pay attention. trivia time. Ryan, Voltron Ranger sent us a picture of the TMNT, the Turtles pies.
Yep.
He asked us the question, what prize was in every Turtles pies?
Yep. Do you remember?
I actually did a Google image search of these Turtle pies. No, I did a Google image search.
Yeah.
Because my God, are these the most unappetizing things I've ever seen in my entire life. These?
Alex and I were talking about these a while back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. He loved these things back in the day.
I do not think I would allow my kids to eat these.
Well, they didn't have chocolate, so you know I'm in.
Right.
And it was turtles, so you know I'm in.
Right.
But did you know what was the prize? Or did you not? You'd never even seen these things before.
No, I never have.
No.
Which means you failed me, Ryan.
Yeah.
As a friend. We've only been best friends for 30 years.
Teddy Ruxpin over there.
Don't be hating on my Teddy Ruxpin. What's funny, though, is I apparently found a Google during the Google image search, I came across a picture. Apparently, there's a website, The Surfing Pizza. They have the 15 most ridiculous Ninja Turtle figures, and there's a sumo Raphael. What a fat bastard.
Oh, I remember that one, yeah.
He's got bitch tits, too. I love it.
So should we tell the listeners?
I'm ashamed to say I don't know the answer to the question. Ryan, name that prize.
I'm not going to do it. No, I'm not going to do it.
Why not?
I'm going to let our listeners go out and find out. Or if they're listening right now. Ah, gosh, I don't know.
Ryan.
Should I just say it?
Here's the thing.
Because I remembered.
Ecto Cooler pops up in the Google image search, too, by the way. Remember Ecto Cooler?
Of course.
God, it was great.
All right, so this is the Hostess Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle pies filled with vanilla pudding power.
And what was the icing? It was green. Was it just K-crossing the icing or what?
The outside was – it wasn't icing. It was just like a green pocket filled with vanilla pudding.
By the way, I just found food.com has a recipe for how to make these.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
By
apparently user 80s guy submitted it. Takes an hour and 30 minutes. 80s guy. Yeah. Takes an hour and 30 minutes to make. Ryan, what was the toy? What was the prize?
The prize.
Was it nutrition?
It's all about them trading cards. Come on now. And you can guarantee that our missing co-host Alex Rodriguez, you know he's got these trading cards too. So.
That pudgy bastard. Of course he does.
Yeah, he's got them. So.
I love Alex. I love him.
I'll take the next one. So we got a message from Josh Denton down there in Australia, down there in the outback. We were trying to meet up actually, but we couldn't quite make it work out. It was beginning of the school year down there and everything. So. We'll make it work, Josh. I'll be down there again in May, so hopefully we can make it work out then. But send us a photo with some of the Nick Turtles. I think those are from McDonald's. They definitely look like
they're McDonald's. They're not the ones that I have when they originally came out to McDonald's, and my hookup at McDonald's gave me every single toy.
Yeah.
But no, it definitely does look like McDonald's.
These are the new ones. These are you should see if you can get the new ones that are there.
Yeah, right. I should definitely hit him up.
And he's got size in the back of his truck, which is awesome.
That's funny.
Fantastic.
All right, I'll let you do the next one.
Larry B. Killian at Bookworm Painter. He tweeted us. He said, look what I picked up to do a review on. Comes out next month. It's the Turtles Ghostbusters series. And this was great. This was the sewer den on Twitter. He tweeted this out during the Grammys. He says, I don't care about the Grammys because TMNT got snubbed back in the 90s.
You know what? I recently found out a few days ago, and I've already forgotten it. Apparently, you can actually – I found out the name of the girl who played April in the original show's run. And then it's really funny because then afterwards it goes, nobody knows the name of the actress who did it when they went out again.
Oh, my gosh. Seriously?
This was from the TMNTpedia page, by the way.
Wow.
That is such an underrated resource, by the way. All right, I'm going to take over these next two here because I was the one that actually responded to our listener, Luke Ryan at Breeders 91. He sent us a picture of he's getting a tattoo done in honor of the 25th anniversary edition of the 1990 movie. And it's on his leg, and he started out with Leo. Leo sort of leaning into his cheek, kind of giving a smug look like Leo likes to do because he's a smug bastard. And whoever did it is really – it's a really good tattoo. The artistry is great. The look is great. It's a legit tattoo. Then he followed up. He sent us a follow-up. He tweeted us out, Luke Ryan at Breeders 91. He said, guys, I added Raph to my leg. What do you think? And it's Raphael wearing his fedora and his trench coat. And these are all kind of bust-like pictures. They're all kind of from the chest up. I responded with Bossa Nova, that's awesome. All you're missing now is Donatello in the truck and Michelangelo with the turtle wax. To which he responded, you read my mind. So looking forward to Luke Ryan's progress in this.
Yeah, no, they're fantastic.
It's an awesome tattoo, and I can't wait to see Donnie in the truck and Mikey with the turtle wax. Because, you know, you think of the four turtles, like if there's one shot in the movie, like that's kind of it. You know what I mean? Raph in the trench coat, Donnie in the truck, Mikey pointing to the turtle wax. Exactly. And now we're gonna go to my favorite mutated message.
Oh, jeez.
And Ryan's already upset that I'm already bringing this up. So, in the last episode, we got a tweet from a fan who drew a picture of herself as Shredder. And me, having no drawing skills whatsoever, I actually said, like, man, that's so cool. I wish somebody would draw me as Shredder. To which our friend of the show... he's now in the friend of the show Hall of Fame. I'm gonna form this right now, and he's in here. Our friend Sal Otero at Lee Shenlong 10 tweeted back, "I'll draw Darby as Shredder," and I just went nuts. I was like, "What? Somebody's gonna draw me as Shredder? That's awesome!" Ryan was like, "Damn you, Sal, for making Darby's ego already bigger than it already is." Da, 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 da. So he actually.
This was before we ever saw it.
Huh?
This was even before we ever saw it.
This was before we ever saw it. So then Sal hit me up on Facebook and asked me, hey, do you have any pictures that you want me to use as a reference? I sent him a couple. I literally sent him like two. Like, okay, this is a front shot. This is my profile pic. That it's like a side shot, whatever. And then he actually, you know what? He came through big. Sal sent he sent me a picture. He tweeted out – well, he sent it to me first on Facebook, and then I tweeted it out, a picture of me dressed as Shredder, which I immediately tweeted out right afterwards. It's me in Shredder armor, and then in the background, it's the Shredder helmet, sort of on a helmet-placing bust, I guess you'd call it. And Sal, dude, he actually – remember when you asked me if I have any new additions? Sal is actually going to send me the original.
Wow.
So that's going to be my latest edition when it comes. I've already got it. I'm already planning to frame it. I'm going to put it right next to my framed Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle pictures that I have behind me. I'm going to put it right back there. I've already got this plan. And then Sal actually told me, I said, you know, thank you so much. And he said, anytime. And then he told me he shared the podcast with a huge TMNT group.
Ooh.
So hopefully we have a lot of new listeners, thanks to Sal, who is now making the Friends of the Show Hall of Fame for what he did for the drawing and for spreading the word of the Turtle Power podcast. Thank you, Sal, so much for this. And you know what? I've looked at some of his other works on his Facebook page. The dude's legit. The guy, he drew a picture. He drew his own cover of the TMNT Ghostbusters crossover. He drew one of those. He also drew a picture of Leonard Nimoy yesterday, because Leonard Nimoy passed away, sadly. And so he drew a picture of Leonard Nimoy. The dude, Sal, he's got some talent, man. And he, if anyone's looking for anyone to like do some, you know, cover work or illustrations, I mean, Sal's legit. And I'm not just saying this because he drew a picture of me dressed as Shredder, which was awesome, by the way. His stuff is good. So thank you, Sal.
I don't have anything else to say.
At Lee Shenlong 10. What, Ryan?
Everything you've said is absolutely correct. It is fantastic. I mean, yeah, I'm jealous. it's badass. It's really awesome.
And the funny thing was, when he sent me that, I was working at the bar that I work at, and I literally just ran around. Because everyone at work, I mean, I'm known as kind of like the nerdy, cocky guy, which is fine, because that's what I am. And everyone's always like, you do a Ninja Turtle podcast. And I'm like, yeah, we've been doing it for like 3 years. You believe we've been doing this for 3 years, Ryan?
This May, it'll be 3 years, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. We've been doing it for almost 3 years. And people are always like, you really have people who listen to you? I literally pulled out that picture on my phone that Sal drew of me. And I was like, dude, we have fans. And one of them drew a picture of me as Shredder.
It's
awesome,
man.
Like, our fans are awesome. That's all. Like, I mean, I can't say enough.
There are listeners. There are fans. There are friends. There are family.
It's awesome. The TMNT community is awesome. And Sal drawing me as Shredder, like I said, I can't say enough of it. I tweeted it out. It's my profile picture on Facebook.
It is. Yep.
So that's how much it means to me. And as soon as I get it in the mail, I'm going to frame the crap out of that. I'm going to put it somewhere special.
It is a fantastic photo. I mean, it looks like you. It looks like Shredder. It looks like you're Shredder. I mean, there's nothing else to say.
He even got the button chops in there.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
So, yeah. Thank you, Sal. At Lee Shenlong 10, if you want to see any more of his work. He's on Facebook, Sal Otero on Facebook. It's legit.
Legit. No doubt about it.
Can't say that enough. All right. So ending that high note, the highest note I could possibly end it on for Mutated Messages. Are you ready, Ryan? Are you ready to bring it back? We're bringing Sexy back. Are we ready for this?
I think we're ready.
All right. We're bringing it back. Character spotlight, ladies and gentlemen. I'm so mad that Alex is not here for my character. I'm so mad Alex is not here for my character, Ryan.
I know.
No, you don't know, because you don't know who my character is, and you have no idea how awesome my character spotlight is. I'll let you go first, though.
Let me just check one thing right quick. I want to make sure the character that I'm going to do I haven't done before. Let's see. I open this up and nope, I'm good.
All right.
My character is funny because you actually mentioned him earlier.
You've done Ace Duck, Rafe Lee. I feel like he's been Muckman.
No, you said it.
Oh, Ray Filet?
Ray Filet.
I had the toy. Go on.
Let's see. Where is my... Actually, you go first because I cannot find my what I wrote down. What the
okay.
Heck?
Are you ready for this one?
Go ahead.
So, you know how you get your characters by looking through that giant turtle book that you have?
Yep.
I find my characters by going to the Turtlepedia page, TMNTpedia,
yep.
And I hit random page a bunch of times until I find a character I actually want to talk about.
Oh.
And this by far, and I wish Alex was here for this, because this is brilliant, and I wish Alex was here. Are you ready for this, Ryan?
Ready.
My character is a character by the name of Rodriguez. Now, I don't expect anybody to really know who Rodriguez is, but here's why I'm doing Rodriguez. So we all watch the Nick Turtle show, and we know that Leo has his vices when it comes to his cartoons. One of them was the space show that he had that was clearly making fun of Star Trek.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, in the episode, there was an episode where, in Mouser's Attack, when the Turtles were arguing over who the A team and the B team were. Do you remember that? Leo and Raph were like, we're the A team and you two are the
yes,
B team?
Yes.
Okay, so you remember that.
Yeah.
In this episode of Mouser's Attacks, Leo watches an episode of that space show. And Captain Ryan, which I think is really funny that that's the character's name, Captain Ryan selects two guys to go on a suicide mission because they're the expendable crew members that every Star Trek has. They have the guys in the red shirts. In this episode, Rodriguez is one of the two expendable characters that Captain Ryan sends down on this suicide mission. Rodriguez is short and pudgy and wears an orange shirt. The other expendable crew member that he goes with is tall, lanky, and wears a purple shirt.
Okay.
So they're clearly, obviously, they're a representation of the B team. One is short and pudgy and wears orange, and the other one is tall and lanky and wears purple.
Okay.
So it literally says Rodriguez and that other guy were chosen by Captain Ryan for a suicide land mission where they would sacrifice themselves so their captain and Crankshaw could survive. The only thing is that they didn't know that Rodriguez represented Mikey in Mouser's Attacks as a member of the so-called B team. He is short, chubby, and wears an orange shirt. So it's one of those like Easter egg-y type, like, oh my god, I never even noticed that before things. And I thought, well, the guy's short and pudgy and his name is Rodriguez, had to do him, and Alex isn't even here for it. Well, but that's my character spotlight, ladies and gentlemen. Rodriguez, nice, the expendable crew member from Space Heroes.
There you go. I'll have a nice Easter egg when he listens.
Ryan, your character? Ray right. Filet?
Yes. So, and this is interesting because you referred to him as Ray Filet. I've referred to him as Ray Filet. In the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Mutant Universe source book, of course, the based on the Archie Adventure series, circa 1990-something. He's actually listed in here. This is why I couldn't find him again, because he's actually listed under Man Ray.
Hmm.
Okay, so let me run down the details here. Personal data. Real name, Jack Finney, alias Ray Filet. Height 6'2", weight 210 pounds, hair none, eyes blue. Group membership, and this is why I picked him, Mighty Mute Animals.
Nice.
Home base is the Seven Seas. Maybe the
That's
Seven
a big home base
here in Walt Disney World. I'm not sure.
Not Friends the Seven the Mighty Seas Mute Lagoon. Animals. You know why it can't be in the Seven Seas Lagoon?
Could be.
No, you know why? Because there's a brain-eating amoeba in the Seven Seas Lagoon.
It's not a brain-eating amoeba. That's a whole other story. They're just all Florida lakes have amoebas in them.
Brain-eating amoeba.
Yeah,
that's why they closed down River Country.
All Florida lakes.
Brain-eating amoeba. That's why they abandoned River Country.
Yeah, it's better to be safe than sorry.
Continue.
Friends: Mighty Mutanimals, Turtles, April O'Neil, Kid Tara, and Murdude. All right, history.
Murdude.
Man Ray was originally Jack Finney, a marine biologist working at the Burroughs Aquarium in New Jersey.
Burroughs Aquarium. Became... Of course a place in New Jersey would be called Burroughs Aquarium.
Burroughs.
Oh, Burroughs. Still. I like Burroughs better.
Jack became a human manta ray after being exposed to mutagen, dumping into a sewer he was investigating. The mutagen had been dumped there by Shredder's men. In the weeks that followed, Man Ray fought the Shredder and was befriended by the Glublub, a race of strange undersea creatures. He became especially close to a Glublub named
Glublub.
Bubla.
It's fun to say. Glublub.
That's great. Yeah, the Glublub. Bubla. The Glublub named Bubla.
Glublub named Glublub.
When Kid Terra and Mr. Null started their underwater nuclear waste dump, Man Ray and Bubla were captured by Null's Oceanauts.
Not Blubla, the Glublub.
The TMNT helped Ray escape. But in the fight, Bubla was accidentally shot and killed by Kid Terra.
Blubla.
Later, Man Ray and the Turtles fought Captain Mossback and his illegal shrimpers off New Orleans. It was not long after that that Man Ray joined the Mighty Mutanimals. Powers and weapons. Man Ray is very strong and quick. He can breathe both in the air and underwater.
Convenient.
He has the dolphin-like ability of echolocation. He is a powerful, fast swimmer. Man Ray shares a rapport with whales, manta rays, and other sea creatures.
Like
he can sometimes use this rapport to get sea animals to do his bidding. The only known sea creatures that don't share this rapport with Man Ray are sharks. Man Ray is a good fighter, though he is somewhat hot-headed. He also retains the considerable scientific abilities he had as a human. He is extremely smart and rational. First appearance, TMNT Adventures, issue number 5. So he's pretty early on in that series. So he's been around.
Nice.
Yep.
Glublub.
the Glublub named Bubla.
That's that. Great. I got to look that guy up. That's what I got from your character spotlight was Glublub the Blublub. It's like the greatest name ever.
So there you go.
All right. Well, I believe is that going to do it for us, Ryan?
That is going to do it for us.
All right. Well, we would get into iTunes reviews, but we don't have any new ones yet. So leave a review on iTunes. And chances are, not even chances are, we will. We'll mention you in the show, whether it's in a positive light, like me and Ryan like to do, or a negative light, like Alex likes to do, because, yeah. Song of the show, Ryan, what is that today?
Yeah, we're going back to Shell Shocked from ocremix.org.
We are going to milk the hell out of this.
Oh, yeah. What's
the song called?
7. It's entitled Cowabunga. It's arranged by Will Rock and Sixto Sounds. The source is Technodrome Let's Kick Shell, the Stage 4 background music. Turtles 4 and Turtles in Time.
Nice. Oh, my God. Technodrome Let's Kick Shell. And as always, you can check us out on our official website, turtlepowerpodcast.com. Follow us on Twitter at TMNT Podcast, because we need to tweet out to at Kevin Eastman 86 that we want him on the TMNT Podcast, the longest running podcast in the world, Ninja Turtle podcast in the world. Follow Ryan at Fig Don Pat. Follow Alex at A Rodriguez 2005. Follow me at Darby T Patton. And you can see that awesome picture of me that Sal drew that Ryan is absurdly jealous of. Like us on Facebook at facebook.com/turtlepowerpodcast. Subscribe to us on YouTube, even though, Ryan, I'm pretty sure you didn't put the last episode up on YouTube, did you?
I'll get it up.
Yeah, you will. Subscribe to us on YouTube at youtube.com/turtlepowerpodcast. Share your feedback with us via old-fashioned email at turtlepowerpodcast@gmail.com. Subscribe and rate us on iTunes. Oh, also, YouTube, like, comment, subscribe, whatever. Do one of those. That'd be fun. Chances are, if there's a funny enough comment, we'll probably mention it on the show. Subscribe and rate us on iTunes, itunes.apple.com/really.
Don't read all that.
I'm not going to. And also, brand new, subscribe and listen to us on Stitcher. Stitcher.com. Turtle Power. Yeah, that's like the iTunes thing. I can't read all those numbers and lines. All right. Well, that's going to do it for us. Thanks for tuning in today, Turtle Power Podcast. And remember to tweet to Kevin Eastman that you want to hear him on our show.
Your Ryan, show.
Any parting words, Ryan?
Our show.
Our show. What'd I say?
Everybody's show. The Turtle Universe's show. This is your outlet to talk to the Turtle Universe. So please, you know, contact us and we will put that out into the world. We want to be a conduit for you, the Turtle Universe. So that's
all. Hey, we're the longest running ones, so there's no one better than us in terms of being conduits for the fans.
We might not be the best, but we've definitely been here the longest.
we might not be the best, but damn it, we're reliable. Good night, everybody. We'll be right back.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's not it, folks. Breaking news here, as Nickelodeon has unveiled at its annual upfront presentation that there are future spin-off possibilities for the widely successful Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles franchise. And that's a quote from the press release from directly from Nickelodeon. So we hope to have more news about this in our next episode. I know the folks over at the Technodrome forums have been postulating as to what this future spin-off possibility could be, but no further news from now. So we'll include a link in the show notes as usual.